I'm currently edging an aneurysm as I start the process of finally finishing this iceberg. This is the Ultimate True Crime series. This is everything in this ungodly iceberg chart that I have covered thus far. This is where we are, and this is what's left. The final three levels. So, thank you so much for watching. If you'd like to see more of this before we even begin, there is all of this to watch before we get to this point. Go ahead and check it out. There'll be a link in the up there part. Now, without further ado, let's just go ahead and get right into it. Thursday nights are for mental breakdowns. First up on the list, we got the Beatty's Ford Road mass shootings. We even got this little 8-minute and 20-second podcast that I'm not going to listen to. I'm just going to read this. I still haven't installed the ad block half for the meme, so hopefully there's no lingerie ads again. It's been nearly 1 year since 4 people were killed and several others wounded in a mass shooting at a block party early June 22, 2020 on Beatty's Ford Road. The Charlotte Mecklenburg Police Lieutenant Brian Crum says he understands the community is frustrated that no arrests have been made. "We're frustrated, true," Crum said this week in a news conference. "Stick with us. We're going to continue working." Very rarely do police officers do, so I doubt this. "We can never guarantee results, but I can tell you we will follow every possible lead that we have in an attempt to bring resolution to that case." In the Beatty's Ford Road area, last year's violence is still in the hearts and minds of many community members. Leaning against a tree on Beatty's Ford this week, Mario Black pointed the tire tracks in the middle of the pavement. "They're the same tire tracks," he said, "from cars doing donuts during Juneteenth celebrations nearly a year ago. God, what fucking legends. I should have been with them. Doing donuts is awesome. The markings are faded, but his memories are fresh." "I know why the tire marks are here," Black said. "It's just weird." "This is the same place he stood last year down the tree when he was recording a video of the block party with his phone, and shots were fired and a large crowd turned to run in his direction." Oh shit, guess it was a good thing I wasn't doing donuts with him. "It was life-changing for anybody that was out here," Black said. "We have to carry it with us in our everyday lives, and it shouldn't happen. That's all I kept saying. If it was something..." What? I'm having a stroke. "It was something that should have happened, shouldn't have happened, because it was going so good, you know, and for somebody to do something foul like that and then take lives like that. Three of them were fathers who basically got killed on Father's Day." Jesus Christ, that's depressing. Close by is a Bank of America where Black parked last year. Beeps from a nearby ATM hung in the air as Black reflected on his connections to three of the 4 victims. "Jama Cassell and I went to West Charlotte High together. He was 2 years ahead of me. I actually taught his son, Darian Stevenson. I watched him grow up. Christopher Gleaton is a part of my family, so the connection is there. He's gotten to know the family of the 4th victim, Kelly Miller, over the past year. Black has organized a silent march that will take place on Beatty's Ford Road on Tuesday, the anniversary of the shooting. The event begins at 7 p.m. and starts at Friendship Missionary Baptist Church. He wants families of the victims to know the community still cares. My main thing is, you know, just seeing those families get some type of closure," Black said. Donnell Washington was there with Black that night. He remembers feeling like something was different compared to the previous days of celebration, probably because several people got shot. "I imagine that's not very good for celebration. The atmosphere was off a little bit, so I was kind of worried about that," Washington said. "But I didn't think anything like that would happen because there were kids out there." Oh, so that was before it had happened. Okay, my bad. Standing in the Food Lion parking lot on Beatty's Ford, Washington remembered running when he heard gunshots. At one point, he lost his flip-flops and had to run barefoot. He remembers hiding behind a car, not knowing which direction the bullets were coming from. A year later, Washington wonders if police are looking in the right places since no information about a motive has been released. "I remember a car coming down. I remember them throwing up gang signs, so I honestly think it's more gang-related. I just don't think they have the right pieces to put it together," Washington said. That's entirely possible. Police aren't the brightest. City Council member Malcolm Graham, whose district includes Beattie's Ford Road, says police are working hard on the case. I'm sure they are. Just as hard as my biological father is working to return with the milk 18 years later. There were about 400 people out that night. He worries snitching culture is getting in the way of someone coming forward with helpful information. I'm gonna say this as someone whose childhood was deeply involved in drug dealing and crime. Snitching culture stops applying when kids get hurt. If it's something that crosses a line, snitching culture stops applying. So I doubt it's snitching culture, unless a snitching culture out there is way less than it is out here. CMPD wants to do their job and do it to the best of their abilities, Graham said. They can't do it unless they get help from the community. The violence on B80's Ford is frustrating, Graham says, especially with so many community leaders making sure it's a better place. So many people were disappointed because so many people are fighting for and working toward trying to build a better community, Graham said. A little farther down Beattie's Road on a recent day, one of the people working to bring beauty and community together in West Charlotte was present. Artist Ricky Sine is a resident of the West Side who moved to Charlotte more than a decade ago from New York. This part of the city reminded him of home. It was a hot day, not great for painting a mural, but Sine said he'd almost finished the piece on the side of Lulia's Market, a convenience store. It depicts the past, present, and future of the West Side. He says more people need to come experience this part of town. I say, what does this have to do with the shooting? Please. It's very inspiring hearing the movement, and it's very tragic hearing about what had happened, but this is not very informing from a true crime standpoint. So my condolences to the people who lost their fathers, their brothers, their sons. My condolences to the people who died themselves. But I'm going to go ahead and stop reading this because you've gotten everything you need to get. And I'm not going to sit here and hit you with the agony mallet for the next, 10 minutes. A Gwanga Massacre. An illegal marijuana growing operation where seven people were... What the fuck is this?
What the fuck? What the fuck is this? That is not funny. That is not, there's nothing.
USA Today, fuck you. God damn it. Here we go. An illegal marijuana growing operation where seven... This website loves to interrupt me. An illegal marijuana growing operation where seven people were fatally shot in a small rural California town had the markings of organized crime. Holy shit, a weed grow up in the middle of nowhere has organized crime on it? That's so shocking. I would have never known that. More than 20 people lived on the property, which had several makeshift dwellings, a nursery, and vehicles used in production. Riverside County Sheriff Chad Bianco said marijuana was processed to honey oil, a highly potent concentrate made by extracting the high-inducing chemical THC from cannabis. All seven victims and witnesses were Laotian, Bianco said. Six people were found dead on the property, and a woman who was shot there died later at the hospital. This was not a small operation, Bianco said. This was a very organized crime type of operation. Yeah, grow op that has its own vehicles specifically for running and makeshift shelters on site specifically for production that is producing concentrates is gonna be pretty fucking serious. Making oil, THC oil, really hard stuff. So yeah, tracks. The state broadly legalized recreational marijuana sales in January 2018, but the illicit market is thriving. This is because of massive marijuana taxes that send consumers looking for someone on the corner. That's because, believe it or not, people like to spend less money. Before dawn Monday, Riverside County Sheriff's deputies responded to a 911 call of an assault with a deadly weapon and shots fired in the Iguangam home. Investigators seized more than 1,000 pounds of marijuana and several hundred marijuana plants. That's pretty impressive. Good on ya. Despite there being no arrests or identified suspects, a sheriff's statement called the deaths an isolated incident that did not threaten people in Iguanga. That's right, if you're not involved with that weed, you're not gonna have a problem. Thanos isn't gonna snap you, the boogeyman won't creep up from beneath your bed to eat your ass, you should be safe. Partially eaten pizza sat in boxes in a circular dirt driveway of the dilapidated two-bedroom house where the shootings occurred. Three cars were parked outside, one with its front doors open. Cases of bottled water were stacked up on the porch, which was strewn with clothing and plastic bags. A black tarp was stretched atop poles in the fenced backyard, indicating a small growing operation. Unlike many neighboring homes, it had neither a gate nor a no trespassing sign at the entrance. Sounds like somebody fucked up security. Reached by phone, property owner Ronald McKay expressed surprise, saying he didn't know that a shooting had taken place at either of the rentals, a mobile home and a house. He had tried to visit the Monday before all of this to check on the well during the recent heat wave, but he was turned away by a deputy who wouldn't tell him what was going on. He said he left his phone numbers, but authorities never called. McKay said he didn't know the tenants or their names. The rentals are handled by someone who works for him. But he said the home has been rented for 3 years and the mobile home for two with no incident, besides the whole grow-op thing. I'm kind of unaware of anything right now, McKay said. For 2 and 3 years, they've been there. Perfect. Never had an issue. Except for the massive grow-op. Iguanga, with its post office, general store, and real estate brokerage, is an area dotted with vineyards and horse ranches that have given it some traction as a weekend gateway for SoCal residents. It's near Temecula, a bedroom community for San Diego and Los Angeles. Deputies in February seized more than 9,900 plants and collected 411 pounds of processed marijuana and firearms from the suspected illegal marijuana sites in the Iguanga area. 4 people were arrested. Am I even still reading the same article? This feels so disjointed. My God. I need more detailed true crime articles on these recent events, goddammit. Law enforcement surveillance in the area has spawned nicknames like Marijuana Mondays, Weed Wednesdays, and THC Thursdays, said Mike Reed, a real estate broker and 28-year-old Iguanga resident. Reed says he does real estate business with pot growers, some of whom live in his gated community. That's because in California, you can be a legal pot grower, you can be an illegal pot grower, both make big money. Residents move to Iguanga for the peace and solitude, Reed said. People live here because it's not in the city. And everyone moving there because it's not in the city is just gonna make it the fucking city. Great job. Adam Spiker, executive director of the Southern California Coalition, a cannabis industry group, said the shootings were a reminder that the sprawling illegal marketplace remains largely unchecked. Don't even try to play the moral superiority card, Mr. Spiker. You'd be shooting your competition too if you could. Shame on all of us. It seems we have 1 foot in and 1 foot out on regulating the industry, Spiker said. Classic move. Climb the ladder and then kick it down once you're at the top. Many California communities have not established legal marijuana markets or have banned commercial marijuana activity. Law enforcement has been unable to keep up with the illicit growing operations. Nice. The risk is inherent in the underground market, said LA marijuana dispensary owner Jared Kilo, who heads United Cannabis Business Association, a business group related to weed. You're never going to believe that. When you have the money and high returns, people want to take that from you. Yep, you'd be shooting your competition if you could. And I've known people who've gotten the most fucked up from underground dealers in LA rather than actual dispensaries. Kilo said the most illicit market crimes go unreported because farmers who have been robbed cannot turn to authorities. Yes, if you're ever going to rob anybody, you'd better rob a drug dealer and make sure they never know who you are. Laotian involvement in illegal marijuana harvesting has grown over the last decade in California's agricultural heartland. People from the relatively small community account for much of the pot growing in backyards and on prime farmland. Large cannabis growing operations typically have hundreds of thousands of dollars at each site, making them attractive targets for criminals, which is why violence becomes worse and worse. Now, this is very interesting to see because it's a bunch of people who were definitely involved in illegal marijuana sales before it was legalized suddenly being like, "Oh no, we've gotta stop this!" Really just climbed the ladder and kicked it down behind you. virgin mindset. The Luness Road triple murder. Really getting to the recent ones here. We have July 21st, 2008. Okay, not that recent. More than 13 years ago. Wow. Homicide detectives last night were hunting the driver of a bullet-riddled SUV found abandoned overnight in a tranquil Etobicoke. What the fuck? That's a weird... Hey, Linthari, have the proper pronunciation on screen or just, like, inject it into the video. I don't know how to fucking say that.
Etobicoke.
Neighborhood with the bodies of three young men inside. All three had been shot to death. Wow, I wonder why it was a shooting. And then apparently driven in a stolen Nissan Pathfinder to Luness Road near the intersection of the Browns Line and Lakeshore Boulevard, close to the dividing line between Toronto and Mississauga. Oh my god. Here it is again. I can't fucking pronounce anything. Mississauga. No, fuck this. I'm Googling it.
A few moments later.
Mississauga. There we go. Mississauga. Fucking Canadians. God. The trio were identified early last night as Adrian Inglis Bannerman, 29, Aaron Brendan McDonald, 20, and Kurt Atiba Charles, 27. All three victims are from Toronto. The deaths pushed the city's homicide tally so far this year to 35, nothing compared to Detroit. Detective Sergeant Dean Burks of the homicide squad said the slain men had been at a nightclub earlier and that the incident may be gang-related. The bodies in gold-colored SUV were discovered around 3:40 a.m., and identifying the men was initially complicated by the fact that they had apparently been stripped of their identification. But clues swiftly began to accumulate as the victims' friends and relatives converged on the scene in the early hours of the morning, including a distraught man who said one of the victims was his younger brother. "I know who did this. They killed my little brother," the man screamed as he ducked under the yellow crime scene tape and ran toward the Nissan before being detained by police. He was taken to the 22nd Division Station for questioning. Detective Sergeant Burks said none of the victims were in the driver's seat of the car and that the bodies had likely been transported to the neighborhood from elsewhere. Highway 427 and Queen Elizabeth Way are both a short drive from where the car was found. As well, bullet holes in the Nissan's frame indicated the shooting was done from outside the car. "We have information that there was another person in the vehicle, and we're making efforts to locate that individual." Spoiler alert from 13 years later, probably didn't go too well. Police said no one in the neighborhood heard any gunshots or saw the car arrive on Luness Road. The first cruisers on the scene arrived in response to a telephone tip. Torrential on-and-off rain throughout the morning hampered the investigation. Oh, come on, don't be a bitch. Stopped by a little rain? Jesus. The 10-year-old Nissan appears to have been stolen or borrowed. A check on its license plate showed it to be registered to an Ontario resident with the Ukrainian surname Chornomaz. Contacted yesterday by the Globe and the Mail, an
Etobicoke
woman with that name said she did not wish to discuss the matter. Yeah, if I had my car stolen and a bunch of people were killed in it too, I probably wouldn't want to talk about it. "It's a great neighborhood. Everybody is friendly. Something like this has never happened here before," a resident of where Luness Road said. Word of what happened, however, seems to have spread quickly. This is because people are bored in happy places. As the investigation got underway, the Nissan, protected from the rain by a tarpaulin, a young woman drove up and told the Globe and Mail photographer and police that she knew one of the victims and that she is pregnant with this child. Well, looks like your kid is going to be on some fatherless behavior. A second young woman who arrived with a group of male friends says she was Brampton and that she, too, knew at least one of the deceased. Then came the man who said he was brother to one of the victims. The triple homicides brought the number of killings in Toronto over the previous week to 6. What? On Monday, William Ross McGill, 64, was stabbed to death. I don't care. That's going to sound harsh, but I don't. So, yeah, that is the Luness Road shooting. There's been no updates. This was the first response. Guy has never been found, and probably never will be found. So, rest in peace, I guess. The Houston Decapitator. Wow, judged off of this name, you're never gonna believe where this guy was or what he did. Now, before I go ahead and get into the details of that, firstly, if you're still watching, thank you so much. Go ahead and consider subscribing, because clearly I'm mildly entertaining. And now let me get into the announcement bit. If you are a regular here in the community, which most people who watch these videos are, start following the community tab on my channel more. Important updates there and stuff, as well as incredibly vague shitposting. Really just the best another pen has to offer into not highly curated text format. You'll probably enjoy it. Now, big thanks to Tyler, the creator's Call Me If You Get Lost album for getting me through this at midnight, 2 days before this video needs to get uploaded. Let's go ahead and get back into this. On July 27th, 1979, a man named Bob Smith showed up to the 900 block of Glenmont in the Gulfton area of Southwest Houston to pick up a co-worker. Secretary Alice Elaine Rankin... Actually, I think that's Eilish? Or Alice. I knew an Irish girl whose name was Eilish, but it was not spelt like that. It was pronounced Eilish, but it was spelt Eilish. So maybe she's Irish, like the Eilish I knew was. She was valedictorian of my class. Anywhere, ADHD brain is taking over here. Eilish Elaine Rankin, while on her car was being repaired. Smith approached the front door, which was slightly opened, not menacing at all, and looked in to see Rankin laying naked on her bed. Oh. With her feet bound and a pillow covering her upper body.
Oh.
Smith removed the pillow, only to see her head was gone.
Oh!
Smith called 911, and the police arrived to investigate the homicide. Police determined that Rankin was sexually assaulted by her attacker and noticed that a trail of blood led from the bedroom through the house and into the parking lot where the killer had taken her head and fled in his car. The head is yet to have been recovered. 2 weeks later, on August 10th, just two floors above Rankin, the body of 27-year-old Mary Calcutta was found stabbed to death and sexually assaulted in the bedroom of her apartment. Bathroom, actually. Police noted that Calcutta had fought for her life harder than any other woman they'd ever seen. The killer stabbed her so hard he went through her body and bent the blade. Later that day, an exterminator walked into the Northwest Houston townhouse and found 26-year-old Doris Lynn Threadgill with her throat slashed so deep she was almost decapitated. Jesus Christ, two in one day? On October 3rd, 1979, alarmed residents just five blocks from Threadgill's home heard a woman yell, "Help, don't do this to me," and saw a man wearing a cap dragging a young woman into a house by her hair before a gunshot silenced the woman. Police were called and found no sign of a disturbance and told residents what they heard was just firecrackers. God damn it! Here it is again. In case you haven't seen the other 24 hours of true crime content here, cops are fucking stupid. God!
"Hey, officer, I'd like to report a crime. Someone was screaming for help, and then there was a loud bang."
"Don't worry, bro. It's just a firecracker."
What fucking idiot arrives at that conclusion? I'll tell you what, idiot. Some fucking yokel who's in the police department. Jesus. Anyway, police later found blood on the porch, because firecrackers bleed. 4 miles away in Watonga Park, 16-year-old Joanne Huffman was found shot to death the next day. And simultaneously, the police were called to a used car lot in the 4200 block of Magnum, where the sales manager reported that finding a white Dodge smeared with blood. Inside the trunk, Huffman's boyfriend, 18-year-old Robert Spangenberger, was found headless, and it was not ever found if his head was recovered. Yeah, firecrackers. Firecrackers, Houston Police Department.
Firecrackers!
Jesus fuck. You know, people say defund the police. I say just educate them. For the love of God, if we had anyone who is smarter than the room temperature and the police department, they clearly would not have arrived on, yes, firecrackers caused a young woman to scream for help. Fucking hell. It still remains unknown who the Houston decapitator was. The crimes remain unsolved. Shocking, I know, especially because it's on the unsolved ultimate true crimes iceberg. But yeah,
That's pretty fucking horrific, isn't it? New York Hotel X murders. Again, another one you're never going to be able to guess by the name. This guy was running around with an axe and killing people in high-end New York hotels. Big thanks to Unresolved Mysteries for the articles that provided this entry and the entry before that. And big thanks to the original posters, who we're going to go ahead and read off of now. The original poster of this article recently listened to a podcast episode from Trace Evidence about two murders about a week apart in hotels in New York City in the 80s, both with an axe. They were shocked to learn that this little-known case was, well, little-known, and could barely find any information on it at all. Jesus, know my suffering, bro. Does anyone have any information on this case? As I'm sure most of you know, there's a criteria for posts on the subreddit to provide a high-quality link. I couldn't even really find one of them. This is all I could find, a link to the podcast. The theory that they buy into the most is that the perpetrator was an out-of-town visitor. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense that he would commit two very similar murders in the span of a week and then disappear without a trace. So the only logical conclusion to jump to is that he wasn't a New York native. He was just visiting Manhattan and decided to make that visit about pleasure. Up next, as the first most upvoted comment, we have something that adds to it greatly, luckily for me. That episode was a good one. 1985 wasn't yesterday, but I'm surprised there's not more coverage. Seems like the sort of story the New York Post would have been all over, with the undertones of something like that that would have fit right into the satanic panic. Might be interested in this, hopefully they work out for you. It's an link to the axe murderer who hacked two women to death in Midtown hotels, performed a ritual with the hair and skull of both victims, according to the Daily News. There is, of course, another article about the attack of the axe murderer from the World News, not really reputable, and a crime update on the murders on West 54th, July 13th, 1986, New York Times. Strangely enough, or perhaps not, searching the Daily Times' website, or Daily News, my bad, website for Janet Scott and Ruth Potdevin, ex-murder comes up empty. Once again, very suspicious. These are the victims of a fucking axe killing in a hotel room. It should be very easy to solve this case, and it's strange that it hasn't been. Hotels tend to have CCTV. Now, I get that this was the 80s, but there has to be some kind of surveillance, or at least some people who saw or heard something. It's a hotel. Either way, it remains unsolved to this day. Tragic stuff. We've heard this story before. This one's just a little bit quirky because it involves an axe. Why an axe? I don't know. 1960s Pasco Murders. This one is an interesting website, that's for sure. This shit screams 2006. It remains the second deadliest crime in Pasco, Washington history. After the shocking 1987 shooting that killed five people in Medina's auto body. In that case, although it took 19 years for the second suspect to be found, both suspects were arrested. On August 11th, 1960, a quadruple shooting took the lives of four people at a home at 1225 East Clark. Police were called after witnesses heard shots. A 13-year-old boy said he saw a man running from the home, jump into a station wagon, and drive away. Inside the home, 38-year-old Israel Fowler, 37-year-old Celeste Dixon, 29-year-old Robbie Jean Harris, and 37-year-old Truman H. Brown were all killed. Police at the time speculated the gunman had picked up one of the women at the nearby Kingfish Club, described politely as an after-hours bar. Harris was an exotic dancer and suspected of possible prostitution. Hell yeah, bro. Get that grind set. Harris, of course, died in this, and police thought that the gunman had been robbed by one of the women and returned to get the money back and then happened to shoot the occupants. Whoops. But no concrete leads were ever found, and in the case faded away. Even with new fingerprint DNA technology being applied to old evidence from the case, no definite suspect was ever established. 57 years later, Pasco police published details of the case on their Facebook page, hoping to jog a memory or stir up a new lead. Its case
PP6005026 homicide. The picture of the vehicles is from an ad run by police trying to describe the potential 1957 Pontiac station wagon getaway car. Ha! Pontiac! Bozo! The other is from a Tri-City Herald follow-up article. How many Tri-City areas are even in the United States? Probably a shit ton. Next, we have 25 true crime locations. What do they look like today? And John Wayne Gacy house then. Impressively, no lingerie ads. Big preesh. The Paris, Texas shooting. Ah, yes, the classic place format. I don't know for sure which crime this is because of place crime format. It's very vague and nonspecific, and it doesn't really tell me anything. Now, luckily, there is an update on all of the entries. You see, I've actually been in contact with the creator of this Iceberg. They're rather impressed that someone has even had the balls to cover their behemoth of a creation. So, I'm having my editor compile a list of every lost, quotation marks, entry, ones that I couldn't find, and me and the creator will be discussing these because they're able to tell me what these actual crimes are. So big preach to the creator of the True Crimes Iceberg, big preach to Linthari, and the rest of these that I can't find, there's just going to be a lost entry label slapped on that. Lost entry. The Corriga family murders. You know, something tells me that every small town news website uses the exact fucking same layout. Light blue, black first word, blue second word, blue highlights. Christ, it's predictable. So, the best thing that I could find was Five Things to Know About the Corriga Family Murders by Kimberly Rubenstein. Jesus Christ, is this like a fucking BuzzFeed article? You won't believe number four.
It's sexual assault.
I don't actually know that, but that's some shit I'm expecting. January 27, 2017, murders of four members of a blended family near Seebeck remains one of the highest interest unsolved murder cases in Kitsap County. As investigators have released details in the case, here's what the Kitsap Sun has learned. Four people were killed. Let's rewind that a little bit. Murders of four members. Four people?
Wow! I would have never known. Thanks so much, Kitsap Sun.
Hey, what the fuck? Hey, what the fuck? Take me back to my article, goddammit. Also, Justin, all fucking news websites, small town news websites, do that for some reason. Investigators have said that three members of the blended Corriga family were shot at a house near the Tahuya Lake in Seebeck before the house was set on fire on January 27th, 2017. Those who were found dead in the home were Christale Corriga, 37, and two 16-year-olds, Hunter Schapp and Jonathan Higgins. The incident began when a person called 911 at 11:28 p.m. on January 27th and said violence was being committed in the house on Tonino Drive and then hung up. Later, investigators released the words of 16-year-old Schapp, "Help, I'm dying. My family is dead. Come now." Jesus Christ, that's harsh. Those words are now on billboards seeking information for the case. Johnny Corriga, 43, was a target of the attack, according to detectives. 2 days later, on January 29th, Corriga was found shot and burned in his 2005 Ford F-150 truck on a rural tree farm in Mason County. Witnesses have come forward saying they saw several vehicles outside of a tree farm gate on N.E. Duwato Holly Road in Mason County, where Johnny's body and his burned-out truck were later found. Sheriff's office said that on January 23, 2020, investigators believe another location was used to hide Johnny Corriga during his kidnapping and murder before the body was discovered the following day. 2. A person of interest. What about a person of interest? Please do tell. The Kitsap County Sheriff's Office says that Danny J. Kelly Jr., 41, is a person of interest in the murders. Kind of a dick move to release the name of that guy unless you're absolutely served. So, that's some shitty police work right there. The bar is on the floor, and instead of stepping over it, the police departments around the world are just fucking tripping. The office identified Kelly after asking the public for assistance identifying a person seen in surveillance footage from the Silverdale Target on January 15th, 27, 12 days before the deaths. I really think it should be law that you should not be allowed to give the name of a person in relation to a crime unless you are absolutely certain, unless they have already been convicted of said crime. You should not be able to release a name of a suspect, because that shit will ruin your life, and for what? 3. Bandito's connection. The fuck is a bandito? Investigators said Kelly was seen in the surveillance wearing clothing associated with the Bandito's Motorcycle Club. That's what a bandito is, okay. On January 23rd, 2020, the Sheriff's Office said it believes members and associates of the Bandito's Motorcycle Club were involved in the murders of the Carrigas, Higgins, and Schaap. It did not say what evidence it had that led the office to that conclusion. And 4. Large amount of cash found at the murder scene. Detectives searching the Carriga home on Tenino Drive found a large amount of cash, they said, in February 2017. More than $50,000 in cash was found in a safe, and $7,000 was found in a bank bag inside the master bedroom of the house. Living it up, I see. The Carrigas owned Christdale's Java Hut and Juanito's Taco Shop on Kitsap Way in Bemerton. A marijuana grow discovered at the residence was authorized under state medical marijuana laws, the sheriff's office said. But hey, Sigma Grind said. And then we have the 5th, even though this was described as 4, is that there's a big money reward for any tips in the investigation. And hey, what do you know? No lingerie ads. Isn't that great? The Preble County Triple Killings. Okay, then. Now, this is an article from Journal News, Butler County's local news now. What inspired individual was like, yo, what do we name our newspaper?
Journal.
Is that... That's gotta be like the name of the town or some shit. Lintari, confirm or deny. Now let's get into the meat and fucking tendies, really just deep dive into the glizzy here. All three suffered gunshots and a handgun was found at the scene, Sheriff says, leading them to believe it was actually a murder-suicide. Oh boy. Shane Elliott, 40, and his children Caleb Elliott, 13, and Grace Elliott, 10, were found dead Monday by deputies after the children's mother called 911 to check on them at the house on the 9200 block of Greenbush Road in Gratz TWP? Gratis Twip? The fuck? All three suffered gunshot wounds and were found in the living room, Simpson said. There was no sign of a struggle, he said. A handgun was found at the scene and appears the father shot his children and then killed himself. The bodies were taken to Montgomery County Coroner's Office, where autopsies were expected to be performed Tuesday. Simpson declined to say how many times or where on their body the trio had been shot. Katie Elliott called the sheriff's office Monday when Shane Elliott failed to drop off the children at Preble Shawnee High School after a weekend visit. Katie Elliott filed for divorce in 2020, but it was not yet final, according to the Preble County Clerk of Court's records. In the call, Kelly Elliott and Shane Elliott were scheduled to meet her for a parenting exchange at 7 a.m., but he didn't show up. Simpson said he also did not report for work at Weaver's Body and Frame in West Alexandria. When Katie Elliott checked the Greenbush Road house, she found the car in the driveway, but no signs of people. I've been out here honking, she told the dispatcher at about 10:30 a.m. She said she did not walk on the door because of high violence and a domestic violence situation, and I don't want to be knocking on the door. Calls were not returned from her children or Shane Elliott, she said. There is no movement of curtains or the blinds. I've been out here for 5 minutes honking and there's nothing going on inside, Katie Elliott told dispatcher by call obtained by the news outlet. Deputies arrived and forced entry into the house. A Facebook post by Shane Elliott published on his page at 1:18 a.m. seemed to voice his frustration with the divorce process. Equality in parenting should never have to spend multiple years in court. I thought the system would help my kids, but I was wrong, Shane Elliott said in part in his post. Simpson said the deaths happened overnight, but he could not specify whether it was early morning hours after Shane Elliott's post was made. Kelly Elliott told the news outlet via message that she and Shane had many years of turmoil. She had fought the courts to get my children, but all they would say is, "You went back, so how can we take the kids?" No one would do an investigation on him. A contested final hearing in the divorce before a magistrate was scheduled for December 21st, but continued until March, according to court records. The Elliots also filed for divorce in 2015, but it was dismissed. A letter sent by the Preble Shawnee Local School District to families of students said the children died as a result of a tragic event. One of the Elliott children was a 4th grader at Preble Shawnee Elementary, and the other was a 7th grader at Preble Shawnee Middle School. This is truly the worst thing I have ever read in this true crime iceberg. Nothing will ever top this, most likely. This is dark. Murder-suicide in and of itself is a disgusting thing. With murders, it's appalling because what gives you the right in any matter to revoke life from someone? Murder-suicide is different because suicide in this instance is cowardice, and cowardice is disgusting. If you're gonna kill someone, do it with your fucking chest out and go to jail or get away with it like a human being. Don't just kill yourself like a bitch, but when it happens to family is when it's the worst. Two children had their lives ended by a piece of shit masquerading as a man, as a father. It's cases like these that make me hope that there is a hell so that pieces of shit like that can be sent to the worst depths of hell. His name is too filthy for even my mouth. Caleb Elliott, 13, and Grace Elliott, 10, had their lives wrongfully ended. May they rest in peace. Leighton Lane Orson. Rochester, New York. Four people are found dead inside a home that caught fire on a late Sunday night. Sunday being presumably Sunday, January 10th, 2016. 6 years ago. That fire was at 193-195 Leighton Avenue near Culver Road. It broke out at around 11:50 p.m. Sunday. Firefighters say they were able to knock down the flames quickly. Police have been on the scene ever since. Rochester police said the four were found in the course of the fire department putting out the flames. On Wednesday, RPD identified the four victims as 28-year-old Michael Royal, 29-year-old Jennifer Leisure, 45-year-old Michael Adams, and 22-year-old Lachelle Powell. The ATF is offering a $15,000 reward, leading for information about the arrest and successful prosecution of this crime. Unfortunately, this was 6 years ago, and this case hasn't been solved, so it's likely that it never will. What's worse is that supposedly someone had told 13 Wham, the news station responsible for this article, that the victims were found tied up with duct tape over their mouths. The cause of the fire and the deaths have not been determined, but it seems pretty damn clear. 2014 through 2018 East LA murders. A man was charged Monday with the killings of three people in East Los Angeles area between 2014 and 2018. So, unlike majority of the crimes on this list, it has since been solved. Anthony Velasquez, 31, is charged with 3 counts of murder, along with allegations that he personally used a firearm in the February 11th, 2014 killer of Jesus Antonio Avalos, the July 6, 2015 slaying of Eduardo Robles, and the April 22, 2018 killing of Amanda Nicole Lopez. His father, Manuel Velasquez, 51, is charged with 1 count of murder for Robles' killing, 2 counts of being an accessory to the other 2 murders, and helping his son avoid arrest. Anthony Velasquez was ordered to be held in lieu of a $6 million bail, while his father's bail was set at a cheap $2 million. There is a quote that states they will kill again, but that's not very specific on anything, really. A Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department SWAT team descended on the residents at about 4:30 a.m., which is how you know they were playing online games and accidentally pissed off a 4chan user. On Thursday, they took the men into custody. A news video from the scene showed deputies placing shirtless Anthony Velasquez into a patrol vehicle after he was apprehended. I would say he's being sent to Brazil, but Brazil is a nice place, so he's probably being sent to some shithole like, I don't know, a really lonely part of Canada. Or the Netherlands. Everyone knows the Netherlands doesn't exist. The arrests came after an $80,000 reward was offered in the case. How convenient. Big yawn. Edit that out, please, Lantari. Avalos was found shot to death on February 11th, 2014 at about 3:25 a.m. on the 4800 block of East Telegraph Road. Sheriff's Captain Joe Mendoza said at an August news conference. About 4 hours before he was killed, Avalos had received a call from an acquaintance asking him to go to the location to jumpstart a vehicle, and there he went to help, Mendoza said. Avalos was found shot to death while seated in the driver's seat of his SUV, and 2 suspects were seen leaving the area. Robles was fatally shot on July 6, 2015 at about 7:30 p.m. after he got into a fight with a suspect in the driveway of a residence on the 4300 block of Eagle Street, according to investigators. About 15 to 20 people were at the location at the time, but none provided information leading to the arrest of the suspect. Lopez was fatally shot on April 22, 2018 at about 2:40 a.m. as she slept in a tent near a homeless encampment in the 200 block of Federley Avenue. The scene was located in front of East Los Angeles Field Office of Los Angeles County Supervisor Hilda Solis. Security showed the gunman, security video that is, exiting a light-colored Chrysler PT Cruiser. You're fucking kidding me.
This bozo drove a PT Cruiser.
PT Cruisers are the ugliest fucking car in existence, and the entire car is one of the few works of automobiles that I say deserves to be put down. It's like a pug. It's struggling to breathe. Existence is pain. We really ought to just shoot it for its own fucking sake. Jesus Christ. PT Cruiser. Disgusting. Now, the suspect had gone to the encampment looking for Lopez, and after the shooting, the gunman ran to the PT Cruiser, which was driven by another man, and it sped off. However, once he was inside the vehicle, the gunman took off his mask, and witnesses saw his face. Rookie mistake. Composite drawings were later circulated of the two men, as was the security footage from the crime scene. Now, about the arrest, it's a big milestone, according to Sheriff's Lieutenant Hugo Renega, as he told ABC 7 on Thursday, referring to the said arrests. I don't know at this point, but we may be able to tie these two to other local murders and also cold cases. Maria Orozco, Avalo's sister, said she and her family thought they would never receive the call from the detectives that his killers were caught. It meant relief, and I thought of my brother, that he's somewhere in heaven right now celebrating, and that he's happy that justice was made and that they will not hurt anyone anymore, she said. So yeah, a happy ending. No, not a happy ending. People are still dead. An ending in which maybe justice is dished out. Better than what we've had before. The Curia family murders. This one takes us to the Unresolved Mysteries Wiki. So that's a interesting place for it. After the death of her husband, Jane Curia and her three children came to the United States to seek asylum because she believed her opposition to female genital mutilation would endanger them. On the morning of August 1st, 2007, Jane's sister-in-law, Pauline Fand, was concerned as any calls to the Curia house went unanswered. Pauline and her niece, Diana Mania, or Mania, however you say that, went to the Curia household, where Diana was the first to walk in on a dead and bloody body. 47-year-old Jane and her daughters, 19-year-old Isabel and 16-year-old Annabelle, had been sent to the life after by being bludgeoned to death. Jane's son, 8-year-old Jeremy, and her nephew, 11-year-old Peter Thand, were also beaten but still alive. Both boys would survive the attack, but don't remember the event. There's an unidentified male suspect, and he's from Kenya, and his ally is unreliable, supposedly. There's extra notes, but the result is, it's unsolved. Very neat, very cool. Thank you, Kanye, very cool. The Ziegler Furniture Store Murders. Finally, Wikipedia. Oh, your sweet embrace. I am once again asking you to donate to Wikipedia. Literally, it's like $2. Just go do it. Just go donate to Wikipedia. Anyway, on July 2nd, 1976, 30-year-old William Thomas Tommy Ziegler Jr., born July 25th, 1945, was convicted of the quadruple murder of his wife, Eunice Ziegler, and her parents, Perry and Virginia Edwards, as well as a customer named Charlie Mays. On December 24th, 1975, at Ziegler's furniture store in Winter Garden, Florida, somebody fired approximately 30 bullets. Of course it was Florida, Jesus Christ. Of course it was Florida. Eunice Ziegler and Virginia Edwards were shot and killed. Perry Edwards and Charlie Mays were then beaten to death with a metal crank. Police later found the crank and 5 guns at the murder scene. What the fuck was going through this guy's mind besides methamphetamine? It was just like, yeah, I'm gonna kill these people. Better have a...
5 guns.
Buddy, if you're not a fucking idiot, 1 gun would do the job just fine. Now, of course, Tommy Ziegler himself was also shot and wounded in the abdomen. Prosecutors later said he shot himself, and they said he did this to make it look like the Bays and 2 other men. Yawning is making me suicidal. Did the murders while robbing the furniture store. Williams and Thomas eventually testified against Ziegler. A few days after the shootings, while he was in the hospital, Ziegler was arrested and charged with the murders. According to the prosecution, Ziegler's motive for the murders was to collect money from 2 life insurance policies, which were taken out on his wife mere months prior to the murder. Rookie mistake, idiot. These policies were worth a total of $500,000. Ziegler has always said he was a victim of a robbery attempt which went badly, and he also maintained that Charlie Mays was involved in this robbery. As recently as 2015, Ziegler has said to his brother-in-law, Perry Edwards Jr., was the person who planned the murders. Due to publicity, Ziegler's trial was moved to Jacksonville, Florida, and a jury found him guilty. He was given the death penalty for the murder of his wife and Mays, and he was also sentenced to life imprisonment for the murders of his wife's parents. The case against Ziegler, and his trial, has been the subject of criticism by many, including civil rights activist Bianca Jagger and a juror who voted to convict Ziegler. Among the criticized points was a judge who oversaw the trial, Maurice M. Paul. Months prior to the murders, both Ziegler and Judge Paul testified in an unrelated case on opposing sides. Although the jury at Ziegler's trial recommended life imprisonment, Judge Paul instead sentenced Ziegler to death.
Huh. The law system working as always.
At Ziegler's trial, one of the key witnesses for the prosecution, Felton Thomas, testified that on the nights of the murders, he, Ziegler, and Charlie Mays drove to an orange grove to fire some guns. The prosecution believed that this was a plan from Ziegler to get their fingerprints on the guns. In 2013, however, Felton Thomas recanted parts of his testimony, Because why would anything be consistent? What do you think this is? A story written down by an author? No, it's just random bullshit happening over and over again. In 2011, Zeigler's private investigator, Lynn Mary Carty, located a new eyewitness named Robert Foster, who on the night of the murders attempted to rob a gas station across the street from the Zeigler furniture store. Don Fry, the lead investigator on the case, had lied about Foster, saying his name was a typographical error. Very interesting how we have a judge who's immediately like, oh, you committed a crime, guess you've gotta die, and a police department who is just forgetting about witnesses. Zeigler was scheduled to be executed on October 22, 1982, however the U.S. District Court in Jacksonville stayed the execution due to new evidence. Zeigler was then scheduled to be executed on May 20, 1986. The two attempted executions were rejected by Zeigler's lawyers, Harold Vernon Davis and Ralph Vincent Terry Hadley III. God, that's a fucking mouthful. That's bigger than his cock, most likely. The execution was stayed by the 11th Circuit Court of Appeals due to inappropriate and inadequate representation. In 1988, Zeigler's death sentence was overturned. Zeigler was instead resentenced and again given the death penalty. What fucking judge was like,
yeah, you're good to go, you're not gonna die, buddy.
And then another judge was like, fuck you, bitch, I'm killing him. In 2005, Zeigler's request for a new trial was denied after DNA tests failed to conclude Charlie Mays was a perpetrator. Zeigler's case denied a bloodstain DNA analysis in 2013 and 2016, and in April 2017, Zeigler's case was denied touch DNA analysis. In May of 2021, a Florida prosecutor agreed to allow DNA testing on evidence that helped convict Zeigler. Very interesting. No, no, Mr. Zeigler, you can't use DNA to prove your own innocence, but we will use DNA to fuck you. Very interesting stuff, very strange. If this guy is innocent, it's gonna be sad because he's gonna die in prison, an innocent man. If this guy wasn't innocent, well, he shouldn't have been as stupid about it, because every criminal gets caught eventually, only the stupid ones get caught first. Last entry! And there it is. There is, I think this is level 15 of the Ultimate True Crime Iceberg Explained. If you enjoyed this video and made it this far, thank you so much for watching. Go ahead and just subscribe if you haven't already. It's completely free and it helps me reach my dreams. And until next time, have a great time. Memento mori.